Thank you. morning. Good morning. So glad to see everybody this morning. Welcome to Generations Church. So excited today to just have a great service and invite the Holy Spirit in the room. It's going to be a great day. Those of you online, thank you for joining us this morning. We're glad, so glad you chose us this morning to have Sunday morning service with us. So if you stand up, even in your home, we got people standing up in the room. We're going to start our service this morning. It's going to be a great month of December. The greatest gift of all is what we'll celebrate here all the way through Christmas. So join us this morning as we begin our worship service. Thank you for being here.
good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it?
Amen, amen. Look, we're going to jump back into worship in just a second, but I just want to take a minute and say good morning. Welcome to Generations, whether you're in the room or watching online. We are glad that you have joined us this morning. We know there's a lot of ways you can choose to spend your Sunday, so we're glad that you decided to come and join with us. Hey, real quick, if it's your first time, we just want to say we're glad that you're here. You are our VIP. If you would do us a favor, in the bulletin that you got when you came in, there's a connection card. If you'll just fill that out, we would love to have a record of your visit. You can just drop that in the bucket on the way out, and we would love to just be able to talk to you for just a second. So we're going to jump back into worship. Let's just take a second and just pray. Jesus, we love you. Lord, we're thankful because we know that you're here. And so, Lord, right now we just take these next couple of moments and we just focus on you. Lord, we say that nothing else matters. Everything else can wait. Everything else can wait, God. We're here for you. We're looking for you. God, we're anticipating what you're going to do this morning, God. So right now, Lord, we honor you. We magnify you. We glorify you in this place, God, because you are good. There is no one like you, Lord. So we love you, and we honor you, and we continue to worship you this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We go back into worship this morning. I think about times in our lives where things turned around. Maybe it's in a job where you didn't struggle in your job and you didn't understand how to do the job, and then you figured it out and it turned around and the job became simple. Just things in your life that you've gone through that you're able to turn things around. But then this morning, for a moment, as we go into Christmas season, we really want to focus on that gift, the incredible gift we got on that day. And that gift came to change the world. On that morning, Jesus was born. So all the things that we go through, all the things that we've done, he came to change that. He came to step in our place for that. So God could have turned everything around and destroyed this whole place out of anger of what happened in the Garden of Eden. But he chose to send a man. And if you think about the numbers of how that miracle happened, it wasn't supposed to happen. If you know the story, it wasn't the normal birth. It wasn't in Piedmont or any hospital. It wasn't ideal conditions. So if we talked about this month, we want to focus on the gift. Focus on giving. I know with kids that are older now, my wife and I have done a lot of running around over the years trying to get the perfect gift and get the things and count the number of gifts that each one has so that one is, because they're counting. If you got kids, you know they count the gifts. You got 9, I got 6. You know, but as we've become part-time empty nesters, praise God, but it's still Christmas, and you still want to give, and you still want to see the smiles, and that's all great. But this morning, I just thought about those that are a couple of families that we're going to help during Christmas, and I don't know what it would be like to not give people your kids what they want. The struggle of, I know even times in our lives where I struggle sometimes to this day that I wasn't able to provide a Christmas like their friends got. Maybe not the expensive things. Well, the one thing we did give them was the gift of Jesus and knowing Jesus. And I read a story this week in just the power of Jesus. I read a story where a 10-year-old girl in Utah committed suicide because of bullying. Young black girl, and she was bullied by her classmates, the only black girl in the class. And she was bullied, and she was told about her eyebrows, and she cut her eyebrows off. And she smelled and all these different things. And the poor child couldn't handle it anymore at 10 years old. And then I remembered our own daughter went through the same exact thing. But here's the difference. When the little boy told our daughter that he couldn't play with her because of the color of her skin, he couldn't be her friend, best friend, because of the color of her skin. Our daughter went right back at him at 5 years old and said, "That's okay, because Jesus is my best friend." So this morning, let's just remember the gift of Jesus. And when we tell people about Jesus, our lives can be changed by just a simple act of giving back, a simple act of kindness. Has God turned your life around this morning? Has he turned it around? Can we sing about that this morning, how God has turned our lives around? And he's up to something. He is up to something, church. And he's doing something. Sing with us this morning. God is so great.
Right.
turn it around. Yeah, God, turn it around. God, turn it around. God, turn it around.
Worthy of every Bible verse of the day fit perfectly with the next song and with the message and everything. It says, come let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. So the next song, of course, we've heard over and over, Waymaker. But this verse means he made us. So all the things in the song of a Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, he had to create us for that to even be possible. But he already had a plan. He already knew the way before we were even created. He knew the mistakes we would make, but he knew the way that we would have to get there. He knew what would bring us to our knees to make us that way. And the miracle worker, I think that speaks for itself. You have a book full of them. But you know, something we learned in our small group is he made a way, but that's our rules. Not rules, but that's our map. That's our roadmap. And I don't know about you, but I think Revelations is out there and it's hitting us and it's starting to get worse and worse. And I'm thankful for the promise in Revelations that we ain't gonna be here. I'm not gonna be here to see what's coming. So I pray for each and everyone during this season that if they think there's no way that they can pick this up or hear a song or hear this or whatever, and God can turn it around. And that there's hope, because we have a hopeless world. But this book says we have hope. And I don't know about you, but I'm praying on hope. Because I'm thankful that he sent that baby in a manger that was meant for animals to give us hope, to make us a way, to create miracles so that we could see the greatness. And he's a promise keeper. Every promise he's put in that book, he's fulfilled. And if he ain't fulfilled it yet, it's coming. So this morning, let's listen to Waymaker, but listen to the words in a different way. We hear it all the time, and I know everybody in here has probably heard it a million bazillion times because you're getting your sleep. But let's think about those words and what they really mean, because he had to make us first before he could make a way and keep his promises. So let's just sing that this morning.
Turning light.
Every promise you have ever made, you kept, you have fulfilled, dear Lord. thank you for everything you do for us and all the many blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you guys so much. You guys can go ahead and take a seat. It's good to see you guys here this morning in the house of the Lord. Again, really quickly, if it's your first time, it's really great to have you here in the house. We consider you our VIP, so if you will just take a moment and fill out that Connect card that's in your bulletin, we would love to be able to have a record of your visit. You can just drop that off in the back on your way out. We also have a free gift for you, so if you want to stop by our welcome table in the back, we would love to put something in your hands as well. Just want to call attention to your bulletin. Everything that we are doing during the month of December, looking forward, is going to be in that bulletin. We got information on our Christmas party, Christmas Eve services, all that sort of stuff is going to be in your bulletin. The paint party that's coming up next weekend, all of that is going to be in your bulletin, so you can figure out where you need to go for that information. All that's going to be in your bulletin. And so we thank you guys for that. If you are interested in giving this morning, we can go ahead and I'll just let you know we have our bucket in the back room, as we always do, and you can give online at generationswithaz.church. That option is always available to you. You can also go to generationswithaz.church if you are looking to give to the Rejoice campaign. All that is going to be on the website, so you can do that. We have, we have some children that we are sponsoring for Christmas this year, and so if you are looking to get involved in that in any way, if you would like to be a part of that, you can come see me at the end of service. I'll be in the back. I can give you some more information about that. And am I missing anything? I feel like I'm missing something. Yeah, the paint party, that's going to be this coming up weekend. All that information is in your bulletin as well. So if you're looking to get involved, if you're looking for whatever your next step is, we got a lot of stuff that you can get involved in. We got the worship team, production. If you're looking to get involved in kids ministry, the welcome team, all that sort of stuff, there are plenty of places you can get plugged in. And so we would love to have you jump in and help us start serving if that's something that you are looking to do. So I'm going to go ahead and pray over our offering, and then Pastor Chris is going to come up and share a word with us this morning. Jesus, we love you. Lord, we thank you for who you are, God. Lord, we thank you that you are that promise keeper, God. God, that your word is not something that comes back void, God, that we can put our trust in it, God. We can take that to the bank, God. We know if you said it, that you'll do it, God. And so, Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness right now as we continue to worship through our giving, Lord. We ask that you would just take what we are bringing to you this morning, God. We ask that you would bless it. God, we want to be a church that gives generously. So, Lord, we ask that you would just multiply that gift, God. Use it to advance your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hey, give the worship team a big hand. They sounded good this morning. Hey, we're starting a new series this month. It's called In Person. You know, we serve a God who is not distant out there somewhere, but he's a God. He's right here, personal with us. I was thinking back to like March 2020. Anybody remember that month? Do I have to remind you? Nobody really remember? But it was one of those months. I remember the day. It was probably about March the 13th or the 14th when everything started changing in the culture. Do you remember that? Everybody started separating from one another, getting apart, and we were quarantined. We actually did a series in the church. It was called Quarantine, and we talked about how when Jesus, after he died, he told the apostles, he said, y'all go somewhere and sit and wait, and then one day the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and you'll receive some power, and you're going to be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria until the end of the earth. You know, there were a few people I got to hang around with during that time. Zach was one of them. Kind of the only people I could hang around with was like the worship team, because we would get to do church services on Sunday mornings. But other than that, I really wasn't around a whole lot of people. Was that true for you? I learned something about myself in that time, in that season. I learned that I really actually like people. That sounds odd. A pastor, you're supposed to like people. But I'm an introvert. I'm, believe it or not, put a microphone in my hand. I changed a little bit. But I'm an INTJ. And so just getting around people for a long period of time sometimes, it exhausts me. I got to go home. Matter of fact, when I go home this afternoon, I'm taking a nap for 2 or 3 or 4 hours because people just make me tired. But I realized during that season how much I love people, how much I like people. And how much, because we were so separated, we just always talked about being back in person. For us as a church, we only separated for about 2 months and we got back together. But there was this thing, just getting together, being in person. We didn't realize how much we missed that until we didn't have it. And as we start this series this month, it's called In Person. We're talking about how we have a God who isn't a distant God. It's a God who's up close and personal. When Jesus was born, he split the calendar in half. I don't know if you noticed. He disrupted history. And when he left, he gave us power. So this morning, I want to go back. I want to start this morning in the book of Matthew. Say Matthew. And we're going to look at chapter 1. We're going to look at specifically verses. I don't have verse 17 on my sheet, Kiara, so you can just skip that and go straight to 18 when we get there so I don't sound funny. But Matthew kind of begins in a funny way. He starts talking about these begots. Anybody ever see those in the Bible? There's this person begot that person, and they begot that person. And it seems like it's insignificant when you read through it, but there's a lot of significance to the begots because Matthew traces the birth of Jesus, his lineage, all the way back to Abraham. So he's trying to prove who he is. He actually crosses the line of David because he's got to be through the line of David. He goes all the way up. Here's something neat I'll point out in a little bit, but all the way to the birth of Christ through his lineage. It is through Joseph's line. Luke does the same thing in his gospel, but he traces it all the way back through Mary's line. It's interesting that both genealogies cross at King David as they go backwards. So the whole point of the genealogy in that day where you came from and a whole lot, it is to prove that Christ is who he said he is, who he claimed to be. He was the one that they had been waiting for a long time. And so in verse 16, it says, "And Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary, who was born of Jesus, who is called the Christ." Verse 18, it says, "Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. As his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child," this is important right here, "of the Holy Spirit. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not wanting to make a public example of her, was minded to put her away secretly. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, 'Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit, and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.' So all this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, 'Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel,' which is translated 'God with us.'" He's here in person. Then Joseph, being aroused from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took him his wife and did not know her until she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus." I want to talk for just a couple of minutes from this subject this morning. Help. Look at your neighbor and say, help. I get on the platform on a lot of Sunday mornings and I say, help. Jesus, help me. Jesus, we come to you this morning just grateful for your provision. Grateful that you didn't shy back. Grateful that you came. You took the punishment that we deserved, and because of that we can have life. We can have life abundantly. We can have life to the full. I pray this morning that you would help me get out of the way. Speak this morning, Holy Spirit, come stir something in us that cannot be put out, in Jesus' name, amen. I was thinking of a song by the Beatles. Some of you might know the Fab Four. They got a documentary out right now. You guys are probably watching it. I've seen a lot of people posting about it. Some of you younger folks, you're like, what is he talking about? But the Beatles were like, John Lennon, I think he got shot when I was 5. Was it 80 or 78 did he get shot? 70? Sometime back there. I was real little. I think I was five. I think it was at that time. But I remember some of my first memories are some of the Beatles songs. But I was thinking of this one. It was like, when I was younger, so I better not sing it. They might charge me royalties for it. I just tell you the words. When I was younger, so much younger than today, I never needed anybody's help in any way. And you remember some of us seasoned people, some of you younger folks, you may not realize that yet, but you come into this world, especially as a young, coming on the verge of being adult, about to be adult, you think you know everything. You think you don't need help with anything. Like you got all the answers, and then you live just a little bit of a while and you realize how much you don't know. Wisdom is knowing what you don't know. Have you noticed that? And the longer you live, the more you begin to seek help, to ask for help. You realize it's a lot easier to learn lessons, and you can move further faster if you just ask people who've already been there, take their advice, put it into practice. You can move through life. Man, if you guys in your 20s, if you could just get this, I'm just telling you, you'll save yourself so much headache, so much time, and you could propel your projection of your life and God's purpose so much further. If you would just lean into those who have gone ahead of you. I didn't like to ask for help when I was younger either. But as I've gotten older, I ask for lots of help. We live in a world where you can get lots of help. I don't know how to do something. I go to YouTube. How do I do that? Like, you can learn to fix a toilet on YouTube. Yeah, you can go on Google Maps. You can do all of it. But I remember when we started last year, it was during when we were in quarantine last year. I was working, it was about 4 or 5 miles down the road, and I get a phone call. It was Justin Johnson, and he's like, Chris, there's a pipe busted in the ceiling here at the church. And I was like, well, shut the water off. He's like, well, I don't know where it's at. And I said, well, go look on the back of the building. So he goes in the back, it's not there. And so I was like, all right, I'm on my way. I got disrupted from working. So I was on my way up to the church. And as I'm coming to the church, I was like, I have no clue where I'm going to find this water shut off valve. So I called Scott Eckert and I said, hey, because I knew he used to do some maintenance. I said, hey, how do you shut the water off? Where's the shut off valve going to be? And he's like, I don't know. I was like, all right, I'll call somebody else. So I called Chris Burns, and Chris Burns does a lot of maintenance. And he says, it's probably over the bathroom in the ceiling somewhere. So I came in the building. I had Justin get me a ladder out of the back room here and get it over there ready so I could, you know, go up like Spider-Man when I got here. Actually, my feet prints are still on the wall from when I did this. That was a long time ago. So I went up the ceiling, into the ceiling. And as I got into the ceiling, I noticed something. There was water going everywhere, and the lights were on. And all of a sudden, I was like, oh, my God, I'm about to get fried. And so, you ever been in a panic situation, and it takes you way too long to do something? Spirit of God came over, and I just calmed down. And I just began looking around real calmly, and I saw the shut-off valve right there. I still had to crawl across the wall through water around lights to get to it, but shut it off. This place was flooded. We had water came all the way down the hall, almost out the front door, about 8 feet out into this room. I believe Justin had walked in the building about 2 minutes after the pipe busted. That was the God's provision for us as a church. But we need to ask for help. Could you imagine what kind of situation I would have been in when I got here had I not asked for help along the way? Like, we might have fried all the electrical system in here. We might have broke everything. We need help. All of us do. When God created man all the way back in Genesis in 2:18, it says, when he saw Adam down there by himself, can you imagine a guy by himself? And, you know, they couldn't do anything right. So he's like, man, this guy, he's jacked up. He needs a helper. And so he creates a woman to come alongside. How many of you guys married out there? Yeah. Been married a while? Still in love with your wife? Yeah, so when, okay, you can see how that person makes you better, can't you? Sometimes. He hadn't learned anything yet. You got to learn soon. There you go. But we all needed help. Like, even all throughout Scripture, you had Moses, he had a helper, right? Aaron. David had a helper, right? Jonathan. You had Elijah, or... you know what I'm trying to say. Elisha and Elijah. Paul and Barnabas. We were created to have people around us to help us do things, get things done. We weren't created to do life alone. We are created to be up close and personal and in person with one another doing life. Sometimes it's hard, I would admit, especially when you're in that marriage relationship. But we need each other. It's very important. Jesus did, would you agree that Jesus did a lot of things on this earth when he was here? Jesus had a helper. You know who his helper was? It was the Holy Spirit. Luke 4:1, it said, "Then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness." This is where he went out there and Satan tempted him. It was through the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus is God. Jesus can do some things on his own, but there are certain things that the Bible specifically states that it was the power of the Holy Spirit that let him do them. In Isaiah, it's also in Luke 4:18, but this is also in Isaiah. It says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty and to the captives and recover sight to the blind and to set those who are oppressed, set at liberty those who are oppressed." It says he gave sight to the blind. That is one miracle that is never recorded in the Old Testament. It never happened. Jesus comes along because it's one of the signs that would point to his identification of who he was, but it was through the power of the Holy Spirit that Jesus gave sight to the blind. Not only is he the one to do it, but if you read through the Gospels and all the miracles he did, giving sight to the blind is recorded more than any other miracle that he ever did. Jesus used the power of the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 42:1 says, "Behold, my servant who I am uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him, and he will bring forth justice to the Gentiles." Jesus leaned on the power of the Spirit. And you and I, as believers who know Christ as Savior, have the Holy Spirit inside of us. Each and every one of us. We are indwelt with the Spirit of God. The question is, are you using His power? There are things in our lives where we need help. We have a helper. His name's the Holy Spirit. In John 14:5-17, it says, Jesus is in the upper room with his boys just before he goes to the cross and his arrest. It said, "If you love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray to the Father, and he will give you another helper," capital helper, "that he may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you." See, these disciples who walked around with Jesus for 3 years, the whole time Jesus was here, didn't have it as good as you and I have it because they didn't have the Holy Spirit inside of them yet. Jesus went on. He told them in Acts 1:8, "When the Holy Spirit comes, you will receive power and be witnesses to me." In the spirit of Christmas, as we come in here every year, we come in here to celebrate Jesus. Jesus is a good thing, right? Jesus is of all the people who ever walked on the world, he's the greatest who ever lived. Jesus, he's prominent. Where's Jesus at? Where's Jesus at? Y'all don't want to answer. He's in heaven. Jesus is in heaven. Jesus is Savior. At the cross, just before he died, he said, "It is finished," meaning everything that needed to be done for you to have salvation was finished, but also his mission was complete. He died, was buried, was resurrected, and now he sits at the right hand of the Father. Where? In heaven. Where's God the Father? He's in heaven. Where's the Holy Spirit? He's in us. We have the power of God inside of us. Those of us who've trusted Christ as Savior. He's our help. You ever feel like you need some help? He's right here. As John said earlier, he speaks to us through his word. That's one of the ways he speaks to us. As we get into, I've read the scriptures many times, and I'll be reading something that I've been reading all my life, and then I'll read it, and something will just jump out at me a new way. That's the Holy Spirit speaking to you. Usually it's time sensitive to where you are in your life in that moment, but the Holy Spirit is the one who leads us. The Holy Spirit is the one who guides us. This Holy Spirit is the one who helps us. We have the power. Each and every one of us have the power of the Holy Spirit available. Now I'm going to tell a story, and the worship team can come back up as I'm telling the story. And I hope Adam don't feel bad when I tell this story. I'm going to take the blame. I got this yellow truck. You guys seen my yellow pickup truck out there? I bought that thing many years ago. I paid like $3,500 cash for it. One of the things that yellow pickup truck doesn't have is all the, you know, right above your steering wheel, all those gauges that are sitting right there. None of them work. So when you're driving, you don't know how fast you're driving. The gas gauge, yeah, it works for me. But if you don't know better, you don't know how it works. And so what it does is, like, sometimes it'll just stay buried, but I can pull over and turn the ignition off, turn it back on, and it'll come back to where it needs to go. Yeah. And Adam was driving it this past summer, and we were making good time that day, I'm telling you. And we were coming from, like, south of 20, on south of Hampton over there, cutting through Hampton. You know where that store is right there by the railroad tracks? He was coming right out there, and he called me. I was gone, about 4 miles ahead, getting to the next job. Hey, the truck won't start. And I was like, well, what's it doing? I don't know. It's like, all right, well, I'll be back there. By the time I got back, they got some gas out of the gas can, put it in the truck. Crank it up. Drove up to the store, and we got some gas in it. And truck was out of power. It didn't have what it needed to do its thing, and it left them stuck on the side of the road. Unlike that truck that needs consistent inflow of fuel to do what it needs to do, you have a consistent inflow of the Holy Spirit in your life. The question is, are you trying to do it all on your own? The struggles of life, are you trying to handle them all on your own? It'd be like Adam at the corner over there, putting the truck in neutral and getting behind it and trying to push it up the street. That'd be hard. But that's how some of us go at the Christian life. We've got this power available to us. All we got to do is get in the truck, shut the door, hit the ignition and mash the gas, and we can go. But far too often, we just sit back. I can handle this. I don't need any help. I got it under control. And for those of us who've learned to ask for help, we understand that the longer you live that way, the more out of control your life will become, until we lean into His presence, until we lean into His Spirit. Give Him control. I'm amazed I stand here on Sunday mornings. Some Sunday mornings, and today was one of them. I say, Lord, I hope Jesus shows up this morning. I hope the Holy Spirit's here with him, because I don't have anything. Sometimes I'll go back. Those will be the best messages I ever preach. But it's his presence. It's his spirit that's brought me to where I am. Today, it wasn't very long ago, somebody posted on my Facebook that I went to high school with. He's like, well, I saw you as a pastor. I couldn't believe it. I was like, I'm more surprised than you are. So, but anyway, Jesus, we love you. We're grateful that you are a God who's not distant. Even though you're there at the right hand of the Father, you sent your Spirit to be in each one of us who have trusted you for salvation. Help us, Jesus. Help us to become more like you through the power of your Spirit. Help us to love people as deeply as you love people. Help us, Jesus. Help us to be a church that exemplifies what you had in mind when you left this mission with us. Help us to let go of the things that we're trying to hold on to and do in our own power. Help us to give them back to you. Help us to rest in you. And help us to trust you in all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sweetest of loves, where my
presence is here with us, Lord. Lord, and we're so thankful that we're in a place where your Holy Spirit is welcome. Father God, Lord, we come in every Sunday night to just be regular. I don't want to be that one that just walks around and is just regular. And when you're filled with your Spirit, there's no way that you could be just regular, because you walk around with the power that you've given us, Lord. And so, Lord, we're so thankful for today. Lord, I'm so thankful for Mari being here this morning, Lord, and your young people leading us in worship, Father God. Lord, it's such a sight to see. So, Lord, as we walk out today, my prayer is that something that happened in the room today changes the course of somebody's life. Even those of us who think that we got it all and we got it right, sometimes a message or a song can line us back up where we stepped off course. But I'm so thankful that when we step off course, you're there to push us right back on. There's nothing else in mankind that can do that but you. So, Lord, we move on to this afternoon and this week. Let us find someone and be kind to them. Let us show the love of Jesus and the importance of Christmas, of that miracle day. And it's all about that. So if we tell somebody about Jesus and tell them the story of Jesus, and we love on them like Jesus, that's a powerful Christmas for all of us. So we're so thankful for the day, Lord. We love you. We thank you for the message that you gave to Chris to give to us this morning. And we received it, and we carry it out with us today. Lord, we worship you, we praise you, and we thank you for every single thing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you guys so much for coming out this morning. We appreciate it. We love seeing you guys here. Just a couple of reminders really quickly. If you are looking to give, you can do that in the back of the room in the bucket. You can go to generationswithaz.church. And if this is your first time, or if you're looking for more information about anything that we got going on or anything that we've said in service, if you'll see David in the back, we would love to have a record of your visit, have your connection card and all that good stuff. Sound good? All right. Thank you guys so much. We will see you next weekend.